afternoon, everybody. Welcome to the Mad Men Talk Show. We have Beloved on the line. We have Arthur Malik on the line. And today's topic is, do baby mama drama breed deadbeat dads? Let's go ahead and get right into it. You know, this is definitely, something that's in the air. And something that's a problem, you know, in our community or our neighborhoods, you know, however you want to call it. And we could go ahead and get right into it. I want to start off with a question. You know, what makes a man a deadbeat dad?
I think we'll probably have to bring some women on the show to properly answer that, because it's all relative. There are women who are bitter and who are angry and who feel scorned, and they would call a man a deadbeat dad for missing a child support payment. Not paying child support, missing a child support payment, or having the payment be late. They would, you know, get on social media, call their girlfriend, call their mama, call their mama's mama, and be like, it's no good, blankety blank, the deadbeat dad. Like, what's wrong? What happened? Well, the child support was supposed to be here on the 12th, now it's the 14th. And so she's losing her mind, not even asking, is that man okay? He lose his job. Did his check come in late? Well, circumstances are, just he's late, and now all of a sudden, he qualifies as a deadbeat dad. So I would say a deadbeat dad, personally, in all fairness, obviously speaking, would be a dad that's blatantly not present with no justifiable cause. Not that he's in prison. Not that he can't get along with the woman. He just does not want to fulfill his responsibilities as a man, so financially or otherwise being physically present. So I would say that would qualify, in my estimation, in my humble opinion, as a deadbeat dad.
Yeah, and I definitely agree. You know, I would see, you know, a person as a deadbeat dad if they're not present, you know, intentionally, you know, not present. You know, I have to say intentionally because, you know, you have circumstances where, you know, you might have a scorned woman who may take the child and leave. And now you have no idea where your child is. You know, you can't get in contact with them. You know, they just became ghosts. So, you know, if you're not paying any child support, you're not spending no time with your children, you know, you'll be considered a deadbeat dad, I guess, in the eyes of most people. What do you say, Arthur Malik?
To me, a deadbeat dad is one who may see their child every so often, but every time they come, they come with an abundance of gifts, toys. They have a whole lot of quantity for this particular child, but never do they spend quality time with this child. I think to me, that's the most appropriate deadbeat dad, because they don't give anything, any substance to the child, either mentally or emotionally, but they just bombard them with gifts and things of that nature. So this also does damage to the child. This is what I'm saying. This is the most dangerous deadbeat dad, because this does damage to the child as far as materialistic things are involved now, because all you're doing is breeding that particular child to want these items. And sometimes what they really need is that emotional or that mental attachment, but they become dead because the emotional and mental attachment is being fulfilled by materialistic things. So that's the most dangerous deadbeat dad to me.
Right. I want to throw a question in the air. And the question is, you know, why would a man leave his children for someone else to take care of? Like, what kind of mentality, you know, can you have as a man to say, you know what, forget all of this, forget her, forget these kids, forget everything, I'm out of here? You know, like, what kind of mentality is that, Beloved?
I would say that something is better than nothing. I do get the gist of what the brother, Arthur Malik, is saying. I would say something is better than nothing. Circumstances do matter. If we have a situation of where I work on the pipelines in Alaska, and my child is in New York, so monetarily, you know, I'm good. I'll be making $45, $50 an hour. I'm good. I can only get to New York every so often. So when I come, I do bring those gifts. I don't get along with the ex-wife or the ex-baby mother, whatever have you. So I got to get a hotel room in Manhattan. That's costly. Or if I'm coming to Long Island, whatever. So yeah, I'm a man of means. I got some decent paper. Again, I work on the pipeline 6 days a week. I can't be there.
But that doesn't negate the fact that you can still give him or her emotional upliftment as far as this. I'm saying right now, what are we doing? We're on the phone. We're touching people via conversation, via phone. We're not giving out gifts, but we are, because the gifts we're giving out is emotional or mental. So we're giving out one of the most profound gifts instead of something that's tangible. So the same thing, like we're communicating now, even if you have that far distance, you can still communicate with your child via a letter, via phone, or whatever.
I agree. Me physically being there, this is the problem with the separation. This is the problem with divorce. When you divorce a woman, or she divorces you, you become the outside man, whether you live up the block or five states over. So now you're the outside man. Remember reality. The reality is your time is going to be limited. There's no way around that. It's actual facts. There's no way around that. The most ideal situation is for your biological children to you and their biological mother every morning and go to bed with y'all every night. That's the most ideal situation. When you start getting with baby mamas and baby daddies, and you got children in Queens and the Bronx and Manhattan.
No, but that's reality. See, the ideal and reality is stupid. The ideal is what we want it to be or what we expect it to be. Reality is what it is. So we have to deal with reality right now. And just like you said, something is better than nothing. So if you have a little bit of time, and it's quality time, that time is more profound than anything to that child.
Okay, now let me interject for a second because, you know, Jamil gave an example of, you know, if you had a job working in the pipelines in Alaska, you know, why would a person take a job in Alaska if they know they have children in New York?
Let me answer that question for you, brother.
Okay.
My freak show of a mother, and the punch you deserved, but that animal's just disgusting.
Apology accepted. And I'm really sorry about all that stuff, too.
Years ago. That's no money. So if a man is offered the opportunity to better himself and better whatever family he may have by going to get a job that's paying $40 an hour, he'd be a fool not to.
But is that extra money, worth the detriment of your child?
Then that's a very good question. Let's just say I'm making $40 to $50 an hour, and I sort of trust fund for my child, a college fund. So when he's 18 years old, he don't have to take out loans or depend on financial aid. I got that for him. Does that count for anything? Is that a plus?
Yeah, but that counts for his stability as far as academic is concerned. I'm talking about his stability as far as his parents are concerned. We know that both of y'all are the nurturers, so you have to get your part and she has to get her part in order to establish a balance within that child's life. So, of course, that does something, but from an academic perspective, we're talking about the ties that he or she wished to have with you. Because they could say, oh, man, he brought me joy, he brought me, he paid for my college, but he never spent no time with me. He brought me a football, but he never threw that football around with me. He brought me a basketball, but he never took no shots with me. You see? So what you give them is going to be meaningless if you don't share it with them.
I agree. You know, like I look at, you know, when I was growing up, my father didn't make a lot of money. But because he was there and he taught me certain things, it shaped me to be who I am today. Now, if my father made a lot of money and he lived somewhere else, but he wasn't around to teach me certain things, I could probably honestly say that I wouldn't be the man that I am right now. Because of some of the things that I learned from my father being present that had absolutely nothing to do with money.
I would agree that time, precious time and the jewels a father can drop on you, that's priceless. Again, you spoke of earlier the mother who's bitter and scorned, who takes the child and goes to some unknown remote area. I've seen mothers actually in the country with children. Now, it's even worse. So if a mother does this and the father says, look, I'm sitting over here in Binghamton, New York, not making no real money, I don't know where my child is at. I really have no reason to stay here. So I'm going to go get a job, Texas, wherever, Alabama, wherever it's paying. I can't fault him for that. Then 3 years later, the mother says, the mother confesses the father through Facebook. I'm putting on social media and says, you know what, I know I did you wrong and all that, and blah, 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 but right now, I think the child needs you, and I need you to reconnect. Well, am I supposed to now move back to Binghamton? I mean, let's be for real here.
Yes.
I'm out here getting paper in Texas, Alabama, Alaska, going back to
I'm speaking on is the emotional and mental attachment to your child. You can't have that from a distance. That's what I'm saying. It doesn't have to be physical. It doesn't have to be joy. You can ship them joys and all that, but I'm talking about writing them a letter. I'm talking about conversing with them. I'm talking about calling them and how you doing in school. About the birds and the bees or whatever. You can do that via telephone or you can do that via mail. So I'm talking about the emotional attachment, which is more important than the physical attachment.
Once you locate the child, and once you establish the type of stability with the mother, yes, you can do all that. You should.
Right. I'm talking about if you're capable of doing this. Is like I have a basketball team, right? And I tell everybody we doing left hand layups, and I got one of my players. They don't have a left hand, so obviously that left hand layup line don't apply to them. They got to shoot with their right.
Right.
So we talking about whatever you can do, you have to do. If it's applicable, you have to apply it and make it work. If it's not applicable, it's not going to work. But you have to do as much as you can do for your child as possible. I think sometimes females can push a guy to the limit because, you know, females with their mouths, we really can't combat them. That's why a lot of times we turn to brute force. So I think sometimes females can chase a guy to the limit where they might not want to deal with her, but it's so much hurt and so much hate. And hate blinds you that they forget about their own children and abandon them. No, but I still give no excuse to a person who abandons their children consciously.
Right. So how does the baby mama drama start? How does it actually start?
Look at this on an individual case by case basis. There are many reasons for which two people just no longer get along. There are many reasons for which two people just can't be mature enough to make things work out. I always seek civility. In other words, let's play fair no matter what. If we can, there's 7 days in a week. So let's divide this time up fairly. I don't want to be a weekend warrior. If I find myself being a weekend warrior, that creates resentment. If I find myself paying large sums of child support for a child I don't even see, every time I walk into I come knocking your door, ring your doorbell, a different dude answering the door, you cursing me out in the street, banging the phone in my ear, you calling police on me. This creates resentment. After a while, a lot of men will say, it would take a very, very strong man to say, I'm going to put up with all this just for the sake of my child. After a while, the matter gets so volatile, it may be best that the person, the father, if he has good sense and don't want to catch a case like Arthur Malik said, that he just, take some time away for a while. Of course, that time away creates more problems in some respects because that time he can't get back. So while he could be building a relationship or a bond with his child, some other dude or dudes are. This creates resentment because what's been done can't be undone. So saying I'm sorry after the child is already 10 or 15 years old, our time has been lost. So the drama comes from resentment, bitterness, and anger on her part, her inability or his inability, or both of her inabilities, to put the child first and say, you know what? We're going to let bygones be bygones. We had something. It didn't work. Let's move on for the betterment and sake of our child. Most adults today, unfortunately, just can't do that. And that's where the problem lies.
Right. Now, I would say that baby mama drama, it starts long before the breakup.
Absolutely.
You know, like if you have somebody that you're in a relationship with and y'all have a child, a lot of times the men do things to these women, maybe cheat on them, maybe domestic violence, maybe beat them up. Maybe abusive in some way, whether it's physically, mentally, whether it's emotionally. The woman, you have certain things that you can use as a weapon. You can use a gun or a knife, but if you use that gun or a knife, you're going to jail. But see, here in America, it's legal to use your child as a weapon. So things might have transpired that caused her pain. And now she's trying to figure out how can she get revenge? How can she get you back? How can she hurt you the most without her risking her freedom or without her risking her life? So what she'll do is she'll use the child as a weapon. Okay.
That's the problem right there. That's the get back. And the get back is going to cost the child more than anybody else.
Right, but the question is, how does baby mama drama start? Because, you know, we wanna see where it starts, and we wanna see, as men, how can men avoid the baby mama drama?
My opinion how it was initiated is this, is that, you know, if we in Manhattan right now and we walking past a restaurant and we say, wow, this restaurant look good. Okay, let's go inside. We're going to try it. But just because it look good on the outside, when we get inside, we still going to ask for the what? The menu.
Right.
We want to know what it got. We want to know what you're capable of. We want to know what you're serving here. But oftentimes, if not nowadays, when couples meet, the physical features is just enough. I don't even want to see the menu. I don't want to know what's on the menu. That's a fact. What I see, I just want that. Let me get some of that. The physical is enough. So now, when you're thinking irrational, you're thinking with your lower desires, you're engaged. Now, you want to have a conversation. You can't. There is none. You didn't check the menu. You didn't know that she was incapable, he was incapable of holding the conversation after the fact. You didn't know he or she wanted to hold hands and walk to the park. You didn't know if he or she was clean or dirty. You see? So when we don't check the menu, we are lining ourselves up way before a pregnancy take place, way before an engagement take place, marriage take place. We setting ourselves up when we don't check the menu and see what each other's about.
Right. Yeah, that's profound right there.
I agree. We touched on that yesterday when I gave the scenario whereby I said we deal in a world of superficiality. So a woman had a checklist, and her checklist is straight superficial. It's straight, I don't date light-skinned dudes. I don't date dark-skinned dudes. I don't date skinny dudes. I don't date dudes that don't have Benzes and Beamers and Jaguars. She never said, I don't date murderers. I don't date drug dealers. I don't date rapists. I don't date dudes that, you know, don't have jobs. This is just straight superficial. It's shallow. I don't date dudes who wear glasses. I don't date dudes who wear braces. Everything with her is physical. So now, she kind of gets what her hand calls for. She gets a dude that you could just look at him and read, I cheat on women. I beat women. It's written all over his forehead. She don't see it. Everybody else sees it. And she gets with this dude, makes babies with him. He does exactly what everybody told her. Now she's on Facebook saying many this and many that. No, you started off with poor choices. You made a poor choice. You had options. When you go to the woman, you got options. You don't have to choose this one. You can choose that one. You made a poor choice. The same applies to men. We chase our lower selves. We pick women that look good. On our menu, on our list of things that we don't want, we don't mention character. We don't mention substance. Is she a virgin? Does she go to church? Does she go to the mosque? You know, how was she raised? Who's our parents? We don't check, that's not all she does. I check this is how fat her butt is, how nice her hips are, how she's curved, is she got a flat stomach, is she got long hair, is her hair hard, is she light skinned? So that's because we chase after our lower desires and everything is just physical, like the brother said, that's probably mistake number one. Of course, we all naturally want something that's good to look at, that's understandable, but we have to balance that out with character and substance. When we don't do that, that's where the problem lies.
Yeah, now this, you know, now responding to what Malik was saying about the restaurant analogy, you know, like sometimes like you can order your food. I went into a restaurant yesterday and I ordered some loaded fries and I asked for my fries with no meat. And when the fries came, it had bacon bits on the fries. So now, you know, when you order something that's on the menu and you see it's not right, you know, I think at that point, it's time to fix it. You know, you call a waiter and you say, listen, waiter, you know, I ordered no meat and I know there's bacon, you know, on my fries. Can you take it back and can you fix it? And I think a lot of time as men, we give up too quickly.
I want to share a story with the world. Cause, you know, it's going to be viewed by the world, hopefully.
Mm-hmm.
I have a good friend, good brother, and he was in a Teach for America program under Bill Clinton, and he was in Texas teaching, and there was a physical attraction, I guess, some kind of attraction between him and another young lady who was very, very beautiful, and what he told me, and this deals with standards and making good choices, and he said that one day, on a Monday, he asked her, what did you do this weekend? And she said, I went to some party, either Omega Psi Phi, or Phi Beta Sigma, some black fraternity party, and he said, what'd you do there? He said, I drunk some blue juice, some blue oil, something she drunk in was blue. He looked at her and said, some type of intoxicant. He looked at her and said, she's a school teacher. He looked at her and said, could you by chance tell me what was in the drink that made it blue? And she paused and kind of looked in the space, and he paused and he just walked away. And I said, oh, I thought that, you know, that was possible, you know, that was some potential for y'all to be something, to be an item. He said, no, dear brother, I'm not even judging her. I said, what do you mean? He said, I'm not saying she's a bad person. He's saying, I'm saying that if she's a school teacher who spends her weekends going to parties and drinking intoxicants and does not know what's in the intoxicant, then she's not, one, fit to be my wife, and two, she's not fit to be the mother of my children. And I was like, whoa, I mean, like, there's no hope. I mean, I thought that could be fixed. But for him, he knew who he was. And for him, that was a deal breaker. Just something simple as that. Like, I'm not trying to make her sober, make her not do anything. I want her to be where I want her to be when I catch her, when I get her. I'm not trying to reform her, change her. That's what she does, what she does. I'm not saying she's a bad person for drinking recreationally.
That's kind of deep, though. That's kind of profound from his perspective. I'm talking about, and when I hear stuff like that, it bothers me because I know that everyone has a background. And because she's not what he expects her to be, that doesn't mean that she can't transform. She can't make a transformation and become that. And what I'm saying is this, because once you know who you are, once you know how special you are as a person, you know how special people are, because it's not just applicable to you. So when you find your specialness, and you know that you was in the darkness all your life, and you find your specialness, you know that you always had that. But sometimes it takes circumstances to withdraw it from you. So I don't really feel when dudes or females come at somebody like that, oh, she's not good enough, or he's not good enough, boom, boom, and you didn't even attempt, because it's just a merely attempt to say, sister, you're better than that. Okay. You're greater than that. You don't need that. She might have took heed. She might have took heed.
Now, watch this. We have to be careful of not assuming that everyone has those qualities. Obviously, the brother's not trying to be Elijah Muhammad or Prophet Muhammad or Jesus. He didn't say he was a reformer. He said he had some standards, and his standards would not allow him to marry a woman that does that on the weekend. That's his right. He can't knock his right. Choose whatever you want to choose.
Right. And I could respect the person's standards, but, you know, we all should be striving for greatness. Now, people always compare Michael Jordan and LeBron James, right? But one thing that made Michael Jordan great is he had the ability to make his teammates better.
Yes.
See, LeBron James is lacking that ability. He has to have a ready-made team to win a ring.
True.
And if you're striving for greatness, then there's no such thing as this person is not good enough or that person is not good enough. As long as this person is part of the team, then your job as the captain is to bring out their greatness.
That's right.
No, we're not disputing that, and that quality has to be in you. Now, he knows himself, and he knows I don't even have the patience for that kind of stuff. That's not me. You know, I'm not an AA counselor, you know. That's not what I do. I'm not an NA counselor. I'm not trying to go there with her. I think he made the best decision. No, we're not disputing that, and that quality has to be in you. Now, he knows himself, and he knows I don't even have the patience for that kind of stuff. That's not me. You know, I'm not an AA counselor, you know. That's not what I do. I'm not an NA counselor. I'm not trying to go there with her. I think he made the best decision in getting what was best for him. He ended up getting married to a sister who don't have them kind of problems. He ended up staying married to her, having four children with her, and he didn't have to deal with that. There's some things that are different because you know yourself, you know what? I don't deal with smokers. I can't stand a smoker's breath. I can't stand the scent in the clothing. It chokes me up, so I'm not going to even go that route. I'm not going to go there because I know it's not me. If you can handle that, then more power to you. But sometimes,
right, but you know, every female you encounter or look sexy to you is not meant to have an intimate relationship. Sometimes it's just meant to have a relationship, you see? So no matter what, it might not have worked out for him and her to be married. It might have worked out for him to share a message to help her. Maybe she got cancer now, dying from smoking or whatever. Maybe she got cirrhosis of the liver, now she's dying from drinking. But if he would have had the time out, if he would have had that compassion for another human being and said, listen, sister, I know, you know, your way is your way, and I have to respect that, but I just need to let you know that, listen, you can live a little longer if you stop this. You can live a little longer if you stop doing this. He might have saved her life.
No, I don't know what else he may have told her or didn't tell her. I'm just telling you that story for the reason that we're talking about how do we get to the point of what's the origin of Baby Mama drama. And I'm saying it's choices. He chose not to even deal with that. He chose to marry a woman who never drank in her life and still don't drink. So therefore, he don't even have to deal with some of his children. Oh, pardon mommy, she's drunk right now.
I understand that it's a choice, but my thing is this, that you can never lift anyone up by putting them down.
No, only I
say that because if you take a dirty diamond and a clean diamond, they're both still worthy. They both still diamonds, but one just don't understand its worth. So
right.
Sometimes that clean diamond has to, you know, implement some things so that diamond can come on and shine so it can understand its worth also. That's all I'm saying.
This is his wording. Listen to my wording, because words are important, as you say.
Yeah.
And I'm not judging her. I'm not even saying she's a bad person.
Right.
I'm for me. Well, that's fine. That's all he's saying. He said, I'm not saying she's bad because she recreationally drinks. I'm just saying I don't want that for the mother of my children or my wife.
I understand you 1,000%, but what I'm saying, listen, I care about you, beloved, right? I care about John, right? So let's say I care about my brothers before I meet them. I care about them because I care about humanity. So if I run into a damaged woman, right? If I know I run into a damaged woman, I'm not looking for her to be my wife. She don't fit the qualifications or the qualities that I'm looking for, right? However, I'm still going to try to impede some knowledge into her because I might go send a broken woman to another good dude.
I agree. Now, some of us are into fixing the world. Others of us are into fixing ourselves. So it all depends on, you know, what's your angle, where you're coming from.
That's why I just gave you the example of the clean diamond and the dirty diamond. Once you got some of that coldness and you see that brightness start to come through, we should share that. Not that we become Malcolm X's or Martin Luther King's or we become these philanthropists or whatever. But we need to begin to care about each other. We're talking about rectifying dysfunctional behaviors in society. And the only way we can do that, we care about each other enough to rectify these dysfunctional behaviors.
And compassion and patience had its place. However, those are not qualities that everyone possesses. So know yourself. He knew himself. You know, he don't want to deal with all that. That's his business. I have a problem with him. I think that's a good thing on his part.
So I think, you know, once you flip the coin, that would make him not worthy of being a husband more than her not worthy of being a wife.
Absolutely not. He's trying to be a very good husband, actually. Absolutely not.
Right. How did you define that? But you don't live with him. That's what we do a lot, though, because I may have a good friend. He treats me good. I may say, automatically, because he treats me good, I think he's a good husband, but that don't imply that. He could be the worst husband in the world.
I agree.
So he might not. If he can't humble himself that much to try to help someone else, John, I agree with John. He might not be the worthy husband.
Right. He's not worthy for her. The origin of baby mama drama. And I think if he would have got with her and that problem wouldn't have been fixed, it could have caused some serious problems down the line. So he sidestepped that. He saw it coming. He got out the way. Like, that's not for me on that level.
You know what I agree with right now? Because if he would have got with her, right, it would have been drama. You know why? Because in his head already, he don't like these certain things about her. So soon she showed him, he's going to be mad. He's going to be angry. But if he had the connotation that, oh, I disagree with certain things she do, I don't like it, but I'm going to help work with him, we're going to get through it, then it won't get him as angry.
Let me know the scenario. I'm giving counsel to a man who tells me his wife has a problem with cocaine. I first time I met him, his brother, where did you discover this problem? He said, well, when I met her and we was courting, she was kind of dealing with cocaine issues. I said,
okay.
And you still chose to marry her. You know what that means now? You have to deal with that. You have to deal with that now. And you chose to put her on your team. You had other options. So if you want to play drug counselor, husband, nurturer, Mr. Compassion, Mr. Patient, that's great. Go ahead and do you. If you're not built for that, you don't have those qualities, maybe you should not have stepped into that role because a husband entails all of that. Nurturer, Mr. Kindness, Mr. Patience, Mr. Tolerance. If you don't possess those qualities, it's going to be very frustrating for you when you see her sniffing all day long. But she got the sniffles and, is you know, drains coming from her nose and dudes are knocking on your door and telling her more cocaine. That's going to drive you crazy. So if you know you're not built like that, don't step into that arena. Know yourself. That's what I'm
saying. Right. See, but beloved, is a couple of things you mentioned when I asked the question. One of the things you mentioned was maturity. Another one you mentioned was patience. And you keep bringing up patience, patience, patience. Now, we know patience is a virtue. So if you lack patience, which is definitely 100% needed in every relationship, then you're the one with the problem, not the person who's on cocaine. Let me explain. The person who's on cocaine could go cold turkey for 3 days, enter a program, and be fixed. But after this person is rehabilitated, you still the person who's dealing with your patient issues.
Agreed.
You understand what I'm saying? So the person who enters a relationship, you have to enter the relationship knowing that through the years, there's going to be problems. Maybe it's cocaine. Maybe it's alcohol. Maybe it's cigarettes. You know, I'm just mentioning things that you brought up. You know, or it could be something else. Now, to deal with all of these problems with a person that you love, you have to have patience.
That virtue
called patience is something that you have to grasp before you even enter the relationship. That would, to me, make you more not worthy than the person.
And that's why I say, again, no, I applaud my friend for knowing what he was built for, knowing his threshold. That's why I don't knock him. He knew his threshold. Like, listen, I'm not built for all that. It's going to be a problem for me. So I'm not even going to fuck with all that.
Baby mama drama pushes guys to abandon their children, to become deadbeat dads?
I absolutely agree with that. Absolutely, because every dad's not built for that drama, and some of them might catch a case behind that. So better off that, better to some degree that he deal from a, not step off totally. And it's a very tense situation. It's very delicate. Because, again, I'm at a point now with two of my exes where we have that maturity level where one has got married in July, I'm cool with her and him. Other one has a boyfriend, I'm cool with her and him. My son's 15, the other one's 17. We talk, we have no problems, there's no issues, there's no drama. It took time for us to get there, though. In the beginning, it was very trying. Very, very difficult for all of us because we were still young and young-minded. So maturity plays a factor. Fortunately, my son lived in my area. No one's in Alaska, no one's in Texas, no one's in Georgia. We're all in the upper area and we're all accessible. I also have legal documentation to make sure no one can leave. Another thing men don't know about, once you just have visitation, you really have no rights. I have joint custody and also documentation legally, and no one can even take my child nowhere legally. For residential purposes, or even out of town overnight without telling me first. So knowing your rights as a man is important, so that if you have a woman who's uncooperative, an actual uncooperative, you can still legally get...
So you only have two sons. You only have two children.
I have two younger sons. I have one older son who's married, living someplace else.
All right, so did you ever experience baby mama drama that pushed you away?
Absolutely.
That made you become a deadbeat dad?
Deadbeat dad, but a distant father. Not deadbeat dad as well. I still sent that paper, still made the phone calls, still went to see the child. But it definitely put me in jeopardy. At one point, my life was in jeopardy, and my freedom was definitely in jeopardy and compromised on several different occasions. So, yeah, I can understand why somebody said, listen, I'm not getting locked up. I'm not getting killed over this. It's not worth it. My child's going to have no mother or father. So, listen, I just moved strategically from a distance. And it's very problematic when family members don't want to get involved. No one wants to help you with this. Because that's important, too, to have family support. Maybe you and her are at a place where your mother or grandmother or uncle or aunt need to sit down and get involved and try to make the peace with y'all because y'all are younger and immature. So now that you need some family guidance. But a lot of times, sometimes the mother, your baby mother's mother is as sick as she is. Her grandmother's as sick. It's like a pattern here that Shahrazad Ali spoke about. You know, it's like, where'd she get this from? Her mother was like that. And her mother was like that. That's why you have to do proper investigation to see who you're marrying, because It came from somewhere. She wasn't born like that.
I agree. You gotta check that menu. You gotta check the menu. So, but you, so you're saying it's the woman's fault that she pushes him to become the deadbeat father?
Jaja, no, no, we don't give no license for deadbeat dad. No whatsoever. I use a term where I said I wouldn't say deadbeat. All depending on how he moves, I may say he has to keep a strategic distance because every time he knocks on the door or rings the doorbell, like in the book, Big Wanna Holler, it was an incident where brother said in brother wrote the book. He said he had went out of state to Arkansas or Arizona somewhere. He was, had talked to the baby mother, and she said, "Don't come through see your children, it's no problem." When she, when he knocked on the door, ring the doorbell, he looked behind him. It was 10 cops behind him. He said, "Oh, Blake, I've been set up." "Yeah, you have." "But he ain't doing anything. Can't see his children have arrested. Out of state. Can you imagine his legal fees? The job he's missing? The job he might lose? So you got to move strategically. That's ridiculous."
Right.
I applaud his efforts for going out to see his children, but now that man got set up and got a case in another state. I know major case, but I mean, I guess
right,
people
right.
got people trespassing maybe or harassment. Either way, we don't need no charges. We black males. I don't want to see no police. No police, no judges, no DA, nothing like that. Only the drama.
Yeah, I think in some cases, too, you know, you have a lot of men who don't want to be accountable for the things that they did in the past. Because a lot of times the children's mother is only looking for an apology. And that's all she wants. You know, with my children's mother, you know, years later, when I came to my senses, the first thing I did was apologize to her. And I think that caused me to not have a lot of problems in the future. You know, I held myself accountable for where things went wrong, and I offered her an apology, and she accepted, and we moved on from there. So I was able to avoid all of the baby mama drama, you know, for just holding myself accountable. Now, you have a lot of men who won't own up to it. You know, it's just like right now, the prisons are full of people who didn't do it, who didn't do nothing. Oh, I was walking down the street with a gun and a pocket full of crack in my pocket, and the police started harassing me for no reason. No, it wasn't no reason. You was walking down the street with a gun and a pocket full of crack, and they probably was watching you the whole time. So,
right.
You know, once you hold yourself accountable and you accept your punishment, then you can start all over with a clean slate. And I
that's
think,
why
on an
individual basis, because some women want self-apologies, and others still want that get back.
Yeah, those who never had closure, sometimes they want to get the get back, but... But my thing is sometimes, it's twofold for me, because I think sometimes women initiate and I think sometimes the guys initiate it. And what I mean by with females, sometimes they, especially if there's a child involved, as baby mama drama entails, they will use that particular child as a pawn, as a piece, because the man or the male, he might not want to have a relationship no longer with the baby mother. Back, but she still want to hold on to him. Back, so now, in order to hold on, because he know, she know how much he loves his little precious. Use that, but on the other side of that, sometimes it could be the male figure who does things that's contrary to the relationship that will cause, you know, that cause atrocities in a relationship. So it's twofold. It depends on the situation, I guess. But I definitely think females need to stop using their children as an obstacle in a relationship, and I think. Guys should just stop having babies by any and everyone, because this can cause problems in the household also.
And then you have a lot of men out here that's also not willing to make the sacrifice. Like, I know a lot of men who, after being taken to court for child support, they don't want to get a job because they know child support it might take half or three quarters of their check. So now you would run around not working, not having a job because you don't want to pay child support, and who is it going to hurt the most? You know, it's going to hurt the children the most. And
uh-huh.
And there's tons of men out here that's just not looking for a job, even at UPS or wherever you might get it, or wherever, you know, a person might just hire anybody because, you know, child support is probably going to take half of your check. What you think about that, beloved?
The honorable... Mr. Louis Farrakhan said the black man is under an inordinate amount of stress. This is not to say that other races of men don't have stress. All men have stress. Some have better coping mechanisms.
So that mean men with stress shouldn't have to be responsible for their children?
No. Let me finish. And I've said others have better coping mechanisms. But those who don't have the coping mechanisms, it's going to end up being disastrous for all parties involved. I know of a situation where a brother got a job making $400 a week, which again is still poverty this day and age. I think he was getting hit for $300 or $200. Either half or more than half he was losing because of a raise. He must be accountable for. He has to pay a raise, only right, for all time that he didn't pay. But at the same token, the state needs to be reasonable because he also has other family he has to feed and he has to live. Now, somebody could say, well, this is an easy, quick fix. Tell that Negro to get a second job. Okay, that's not a quick fix because now he doesn't see any of his children. So now he becomes a financial father. He pays his child support, but he can't be around because he's always working. So that's why I go back to the choices. He made some poor choices. Of course, he has to be accountable for that. But we have to be reasonable. Same token, I can't see leaving a man, a grown man who has children to feed, with a check for $200 a week just so he could make something right that he did 20 years ago. No, I can't ride with that one.
So you think the courts should take into consideration that you made poor choices?
Absolutely. Now, for first generation, other children involved. And other children involved. He lives with his new family now. So they want to get back at him something he did 15, 20 years ago. Okay, I'm not saying he doesn't have to pay. I'm saying there has to be a formula where we can leave this man in a position where he can take care of what he owes and take care of what he has currently. Because at $200 a week, he can't save himself. This is madness. I mean, what are you trying to make a point? Pick the man with one he's already broken? This is senseless.
Right, and see, this is what I mean about accountability. So, you know, using your logic, you're saying that if I made a mistake 20 years ago, I shouldn't have to now pay for that mistake because of what the accountability statute of limitations.
I didn't even think about the limitations. I'm just saying
no, because I mean using your logic, accountability has a statute of limitations because you put a date on it.
So it's not going to help the matter to break him more than he's already been broken. We're starting off with poverty, making $400 a week. That's enough to kid's own stuff right there. Now you're telling him,
but it's not
to get you back
because
you get home.
But it's not the state's fault if a man don't go to school, get an education, start
brother,
his own business, or get a good job. That's not the fault of the state.
Brother, we're not looking for or blame. I'm only concerned with one thing here. Being fair and being reasonable for what's in the best interest of all children involved. I'm concerned with about whose fault it was. We all make mistakes. It seems like you have a bit of a how can I put this mildly? You kind of have a lust for setting scores right. I do too, but within reason. Yeah, I'm going to pay for what he did. Yeah, because there were times when she raised a child by herself that wasn't fair to her. But at what rate? You know, I think he made $20,000 in a hole. But I mean, it's serious from every angle you look at it at. But again, I'm not trying to break him while he's already broken.
Right, but that's...
But that's
what I consider to be accountability. Being accountable for something. If I do something to you, I would be a sociopath to be able to sleep good at night without saying, okay, I love my brother. I need to make this right.
I'm glad that you want to make it right. But what's the formula to make it right? Take a half my check?
But again, if you owe me $10 and I feel the type of way about it.
Me too.
I can't now tell you, Jamil, why are you calling me about this $10? That was last month. That was two months ago. Why are you still calling me about this $10? Because based on the accountability statute of limitations, that $10 should be deleted because I'm not in a position to give you this $10. No,
listen,
when a problem arises, a lot of times, and I discuss it with my wife, you know what my wife says?
Figure it out.
Because as a man, there's going to be problems in life. And you're going to have a lot more compounded problems in life if you're not able to give solutions to the problems that arise.
If I'm making
$400 a week and I already have two children, and right. I decide to move on, start another relationship, and get this woman pregnant, at that point when she's pregnant, I'm going to have to figure it out. Because already child support is taking 75% of my check. I'm making $400. They're only leaving me with $100. Now I have another baby on the way. So,
again, go back to what I said. I will go poor choices. Okay.
Right, but it's also, you know, it also has to be some kind of accountability for the
choices. So who pays for the poor choices? Who should pay for poor choices, someone else's poor choices?
Themselves.
Okay.
Never once did I say let them off the hook scot-free. I said be reasonable. I didn't say let them off. I didn't say they erase his debt. I never said that. I never even intimated that. I just said, let's be reasonable. He's already a broken man. How much more do you want to break him? You want to sell crack? Want to sell coke, heroin? How can he fix this problem?
Yeah, all right, too, let me ask you, you don't think being reasonable is paying $150 for each child? You don't think that's reasonable?
Oh, no. He has a debt of $20,000, from what I understand. Maybe
right.
20-something. All right, that's a lot of money. Okay, just have to pay back. But he has to pay it back, though. So he's making $400 a week. He just entered the workforce recently. He just entered the workforce. Let me get a man a little time to get on his feet. Give him a warning. Like, listen, bro, in 6 months, we got to come at you. But get on your feet first, you know what I'm saying? Because if you get a raise or something, maybe that's something you could do. Invest some money or something. Now, the six-month point, we're going to start taking from you to pay off that other debt that you owe, $20,000 you owe. Based on the fact that you got three or four more other children that you live with, you're trying to take care of. Let's do $100 a month. You're going to be paying forever, but $100 a month. That's $200 a week.
You know what's profound, though? But a lot of times we make our decision based on how close a thing is to home, right? How close a thing is, how much it would affect us. Is it my cousin, my brother? Who is it that is affected? Because right now, if that was your sister, that he was doing that to, by chance, that you would say, oh, he better pay care of my nieces and nephews. He better pay that money. I don't care what he's going through. He better pay my money.
That's emotional.
But because that's what I'm saying. It depends on how close to home it is to us, how we can perceive it, right? So now, because if it was my sister or something, and somebody it was a daddy there, and he wasn't paying, but now, okay, what he going through? He should have thought about that when he was doing that to my niece and nephew, and he knew that he wasn't taking care of my niece and nephew's good. And then he goes in and create another family when he know he can't take care of this one. So now he didn't care about somebody. So right. Should the concern still be there for him?
Now, this one, well, hold on. You missed the compassion for the world, right? So let's be compassionate.
We have to display compassion, no doubt about it. But I'm not the creator. I don't have the most compassion in the world. But I do have compassion, and there shall be no weakness in my meekness. Because sometimes people can take advantage of that particular compassion. You have to know who you disseminated it to.
I agree. Now, let me say this, because you brought up my sister. So let's just deal with that one. I do have a sister. Who, in the beginning of her relationship, of being not with the father no more, some very turbulent times, but matured to the point where she was able to sit down with the brother and go over his bills with him and see what would be reasonable for him to pay to her. They also came up with a very interesting arrangement that I applaud, that I think it should be done with everyone that can do it, where he would have my niece 1 week out of the month. Next week, we go to my sister, and then back and forth. So 2 weeks out of the month, she stayed with her father. The other 2 weeks, she stayed with her mother. Got to know both sides of the family. And he paid what they agreed to was reasonable without even getting the courts involved.
Oh, no, see, no, that's beautiful. But see, this is not a deadbeat. A deadbeat dad is not one who's not trying to be involved. He's not trying to. This individual, he's not complaining. He's involved. He's taking the child for weekends or whatever, so he's involved. We're talking about those who are opposed to being involved, who those really don't care about the child.
No, and deadbeat dad should get their just due. I don't know if the brother was a deadbeat dad. I just know somehow he accumulated 20 stacks. And I don't know how he's going to pay that off. Making $400 a week. I know I'm not a math man.
I know how you could pay that off a little bit at a time.
That's why I have $100 a month.
That's the only way to pay it off.
$100 a month. How about that? $100 a week. That's about as far as I'm going to go with it.
Right, but how can your child live off of $100 a month?
This, no, brother, let me give some clarity to the situation. He's paying for a child who's already grown in college.
Mm-hmm.
It's pretty much all arrears. That's the situation. Yeah, this is back money. The child's already grown, so this is some get back. This is what, in other words, like his saying, listen, bro, you gonna pay me for all the times when you wasn't around. That's what that's about. Child's already grown, healthy, in college.
But you know, the real part, too, the real problem, because we hit one side where the women, they chase it down, but a lot of times you just have some real low-life dudes, too, man. They just spurned on, and they're not really there to take care of the child. That Lux got the best of him. She had a good body, good sex game, or whatever. Boom, boom, he ejaculated and got her impregnated, and that wasn't his plan. You know what I'm saying? So, and before.
That's a terrible situation. You know, so that's why I said in the beginning, it's on an individual case-by-case basis. I can't put that big bedspread on everybody. I can't, you know, just put that blanket on everybody and make a statement, you know, anybody who ain't around. Why are you not around? What's the situation? Right in the house in front of his children. I mean, that's not to deal with. Again, he don't get no pass for moving to Hawaii, but, I mean, I don't know how I would deal with that. You know, I'm a pretty reasonable, decent person, but, I mean, your man put hands on me? Woo! That may have a case coming. So you got to move strategically once y'all separate, because it can get real ugly. Real ugly. I don't know how we can rectify that. I mean, I come to see my child, you beat me up? Why, in the house with my children watching?
Right. Yeah,
I'm right, with, bro.
Yeah, right now we have the 5-minute mark towards the closing of the show. So, you know, let's give some closing remarks.
Yes, sir. We need a balance when it comes to baby mama drama and when it comes to deadbeat dads. You know, we have to have a balance, and it's imperative to that. We check these menus, man. We know what a person is about to establish this relationship, because relationship comes from the root word relate. And it's based on more than just a sexual encounter, man. You have to relate. You have to have some characteristics and things that may enhance hers, or she may enhance yours. And we can't just accept anyone on face value or because of their physical features, man. We have to know the inner details of someone, and maybe this will stop the baby mama drama and the deadbeat dad.
Right. I would say for the men out there, you know, you wanna be accountable for the decisions that you make. You know, be humble, you know, give an apology if it's an apology in order.
Male and female, man, we need a balance when it comes to baby mama drama and when it comes to deadbeat dads. You know, we have to have a balance, and it's imperative to that. We check these menus, man. We know what a person is about to establish this relationship, because relationship comes from the root word relate. And it's based on more than just a sexual encounter, man. You have to relate. You have to have some characteristics and things that may enhance hers, or she may enhance yours. And we can't just accept anyone on face value or because of their physical features, man. We have to know the inner details of someone, and maybe this will stop the baby mama drama and the deadbeat dad.
Right. I would say for the men out there, you know, you wanna be accountable for the decisions that you make. You know, be humble, you know, give an apology if it's an apology in order, and be willing to make that sacrifice. You know, you can't run around not working or not making any money just to try to avoid paying child support, because at the end of the day, that the children suffer because education costs, food costs, you know, shelter costs, you know, everything costs. So, you know, if you're making a dollar, you have to be willing to sacrifice at least 75 cents for your children.
I would go back off of what the two other good brothers said. I think we have to at all times be as mature as we can be, let bygones be bygones, not live in the past, and work towards what is in the best interest of those children. Those children have to come first. So getting into back and forth about who did what and whose fault it was, at this point, children are here, that's irrelevant. One thing we discuss now is what can we do together maturely to work in the best interest of making these children productive citizens of this great society. On that note,
right. So, you know, we that's the end of this you know, the Mad Men talk show for today. You know, we'll be coming with you, we'll be coming with another episode for tomorrow. So just stay tuned, you know, like, share, subscribe, and leave your comments below. Peace.